from Luke's Gospel, the 14th chapter, beginning at verse 1. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. There in front of him was a man suffering from dropsy. And Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him away. Then he asked them, "If one of you has a son or child or an ox that falls into a well on a Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out?" And they had nothing to say. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. "When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, 'Give this man your seat.' Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, 'Friend, move up to a better place.' Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." And then Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Jesus, in this passage of Scripture, finds himself being carefully watched, it says, by the Pharisees. The Pharisees, these teachers of the law who want to make sure that every commandment is followed to the nth degree. But they're silent before Jesus. There's a man at this fancy banquet, a symposium of sorts. That's what the Pharisees did on regular occasions on the Sabbath day. Groups of men, Pharisees, these teachers of the law, would gather together and they would have a dialogue, a discussion about the meaning of God's rules and regulations. A symposium, a dialogue. One of the persons there, it says in the scripture text, suffered from dropsy. Dropsy is an edema. It's a collection of fluid. It's congestive heart failure, if you will. And Jesus says nothing. He simply takes the man and heals him. And then he asks these Pharisees, these teachers of the law, these rule keepers, he asks them, "Is it okay to heal on the Sabbath or not?" And once again, they remain silent. They have nothing to say. They're there for a discussion, but they have nothing to say. And then Jesus asked them, "Well, if you had a child that fell into a well on a Sabbath, wouldn't you want to get that child out and save that child? If you had an oxen fall into a well on the Sabbath, wouldn't you want to pull that oxen out? After all, that oxen, like that tractor, causes you to be successful or not. If it's okay to pull an oxen out, if it's okay to pull a child out on a Sabbath, isn't it okay to heal on the Sabbath?" But the Pharisees thought that any kind of healing was working, and working on the Sabbath was frowned upon. But they were willing to have a symposium where they worked their brains to talk about what was right and what was wrong. But what Jesus wanted to do was not to show the power of human beings, but show the power of God and what God can do. And so Jesus healed the man and set him free. We live in a haughty world where we think about our brain power, not God's power. We live in a haughty world where we are quick to look down our noses at other people and forget that we are all in the need of God's grace and God's power. I know some of you have heard this story before, but I want to share it with you again. It was a time when a cowboy, he'd been out on the range. He had been working for several months tending to the cattle. He smelled bad. He looked bad. His hair was unkempt. Everything about him was dirty. But he had an experience with God while he was out there. He gave his heart to Christ. He came back to the bunkhouse. He told his friends what had happened, and they said, well, with some glee, they said, well, you need to go to church. If you're really, truly a Christian now, you need to go to church. And so he said, well, I've never been to church. And one of them said, here are my truck keys. You can drive to church. They told him how to get there. So you come back and tell us what happens. They thought it would be quite an experience. And indeed, he went to church, came back, and so they were waiting on him. They said, what happened? He said, well, when I got there, I parked in the corral. And they laughed and said, they don't call it a corral. They call it a parking lot. He said, well, I didn't know that. And then I walked up to the front gates of the church, and they laughed and said, they don't call them front gates, they call them doors. He said, well, I didn't know that. And then there was this long chute, and they laughed and they said, they don't call it a chute, they call it an aisle. He said, well, I didn't know that. And then there were these little stalls, and I sat down in one of them, and they said, oh, they don't call them stalls, they call them pews. He said, well, I knew that because that's what the lady said when I sat down beside her. Oh, we quickly hold our nose and look down our nose to those who are the least, the last, the lowest, the lost. But in Jesus' parable, and when he's with these Pharisees, the least, the last, the lowest, the lost are the heroes, not the haughty. It's interesting, the word pew. It comes from an old French word, pues. P-U-I-E-S. It means elevation. It's really the kind of seating that was around the Pharisees' banquet table. There's, like in the House of Commons in England, where there are stacks and rows of seating. There were places of honor. The word really means elevation, high places. There's an interesting paragraph in the United Methodist Book of Discipline. I'm not going to read it to you. I don't need to. It's paragraph 2533.1, bottom right-hand side. And it says, under the powers of the trustees, that there shall not be any provision about the pews in a church that in the United Methodist Church, and it's been in every discipline since the beginning of our movement, that the pews shall always be free. Interesting. Shall always. That's just weird. But it's not really weird when you think about Methodism. When you think about who we are, that the pews should always be free. Because pews weren't always free. If you've ever been to Colonial Williamsburg, or if you've been in some different Anglican churches or other denominations where pews are literally shaped like little stalls, you know that those pews were literally owned by the families that had them, bought them, paid for them, rented them, so that you could decorate your own pew. You could put in your own little heater, or maybe in the South, air conditioning. I don't know. It's a thought. I've even thought it would be great if we could rent out pews that reclined for some of you. But in the Methodist Church, they're always free. So it wouldn't really help us, would it? Now, why is that? Because John Wesley, the founder of the Wesleyan movement, wanted to make sure that we were people that were always in mission to the least, the last, the lowest, the lost, the poor, the rich, and everybody in between and beyond, the youngest to the oldest, the shortest to the tallest. That the pews are for everybody. We don't charge you rent. But sometimes we look down on others. Not you, of course. I don't know about you, but I'm more bothered by the haughty than I am by the humble. Even though it seems that our society plays up the haughty, As I think about what happened on June the 3rd of this year, just a few months ago, with Muhammad Ali's death. You know, when I was a child, Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, was not one of my favorite people, to be honest with you. I thought he was preposterous in his pompousness, his haughtiness. I liked his poetic way of turn of phrase, but he bothered me. Now I know that Parkinson's and things of that nature and changes in his life created a whole new persona for him, but I still remember those days. I remember, for instance, one of the first times he flew on a plane, he said to the stewardess who wanted to make sure that his seatbelt was buckled, he said to her, "Superman don't need a seatbelt." And she replied, "Superman don't need a plane either. Buckle your seatbelt." I remember Muhammad Ali's 1971 fight on March the 8th of 1971. It was called, remembered as the fight of the century between Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier. Neither one of them had ever been defeated in a boxing match. Muhammad Ali, in his boastful, prideful, haughty way, but he usually was able to deliver, he said these words, "There seems to be some confusion about March the 8th. We're going to decide, once and for all, who is the king. There's not a man alive who can whoop me." And he jabbed with his left into the air. "I'm too smart," and he tapped his head. "I'm too pretty," and he pretended like his head was a bust on a revolving pedestal. "I am the greatest. I am the king. I should be on a postage stamp because that's the only way I could get licked." And he lost to Joe Frazier. And it seems like the scripture says in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18, that pride goeth before a fall. That's what Jesus was saying in Luke chapter 14, verse 11. "Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled." It says the same thing pretty much in Matthew's gospel, the 5th chapter, the 5th verse. "Blessed are the meek," as the choir sang it. "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Or in James chapter 4, verse 6, "God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." So how do we stay humble in a haughty world? Well, we could all begin by saying thank you, excuse me, and please, just to begin with. So how would we qualify for the Humility Hall of Fame? Even though that sounds like an oxymoron. Well, I'm reminded of two United Methodists who were very different but very similar. Two United Methodists, one whose name was Bob Dole, a Republican, one whose name was George McGovern, a Democrat. Bob Dole lost in his contest for the presidency to Bill Clinton. George McGovern lost in his contest for the presidency to Richard Nixon. Both of them Methodists, both raised very humbly, very poor. Bob Dole was raised in Russell, Kansas. He was so poor that his family moved to the basement of their house so they could rent out the main floor. In 1996, I was elected to the General Conference of the United Methodist Church, and I decided to drive to Denver, Colorado from South Carolina. It's a long way. I went the southern route on the way out there, across the bottom part of Kansas. I wanted to see Dodge City. You know, Dodge City, I love the westerns. And it hasn't changed much. You could smell cattle from 20 miles out either direction. So I decided on the way back from Denver to drive the northern route of Kansas, I-70. And you can see for miles. You can see Pike's Peak in Colorado all the way into Kansas. And we came upon Russell, Bob Dole's home. You could see the trees for miles and miles because there weren't any trees. The only trees planted there were by Johnny Appleseed or by some settlers who decided to plant trees. And so I said, you know, I want to see where Bob Dole lives. I'm sure it's a beautiful, wonderful place. He's got a grand house, I'm sure. So I pulled off the interstate, and the first thing I saw was a Stockyard. Next to it was a Hardee's. I didn't know they had Hardee's out there, but they did. And then there was a little Methodist church. Remember, he's Methodist. A small little courthouse. And then a gas station. And I asked, where is Bob Dole's home? And they told me. I drove up a couple blocks, took a left. About three houses down on the right was Bob Dole's 1952-ish ranch-style plain Jane house, which said a lot about him and his character. He served in World War II in the 10th Mountain Division, was wounded horribly in Italy. Always no nonsense, humble. And George McGovern, also raised in poverty. He was the son of a Methodist preacher. He was Methodist. They were poor as well. He flew as a pilot over Europe in a B-24 Liberator through 34 missions. He flew 34 missions over Germany. And if you know anything about the attrition rate and the loss of pilots and planes, you know flying 34 combat missions over Germany was awful. Both of them survived, though scarred. Both of them became senators. Both of them exemplified not haughtiness, but humility. Both of them in the Humility Hall of Fame, they were public servants. And yes, we are grateful for those who are public servants, but there are some who are not and serve themselves. And they came together, both McGovern and Dole, and they were on the Senate Select Committee on Poverty. And together they worked to make sure that school children who didn't have food to eat got food to eat so they could do better in school. They made sure that poor families got food to eat because they were public servants. Those are people in my Humility Hall of Fame. Both Methodists, I dare say, both belonging to a church where the pews are free. Where the pews are free because we care for everybody and we want to help people, no matter who they are. That's not always the case in our world. For instance, this coming Thursday is September the 1st. September the 1st. College football's first games. September the 1st. September the 1st. You know, this is the perfect time to be a University of South Carolina alumna because we haven't lost yet. I'm just saying. I mean, this is that magical time. That magical, magical time. I always like, before football season starts, I like to find out about new rules because there are always new rules. And particularly, I wanted to find out if there were any new rules with college football, not just pros. And they're not. But there's one set of rules that I wouldn't mind seeing changed, perhaps. It's the rule about excessive celebrations. Now, it's not that South Carolina gets to have that many excessive celebrations. I even heard about last year in the Carolina-Clemson game that a Carolina player was walking off the field at halftime, and he noticed this white, powdery substance, reported it. They called in the FBI. They did a field study to find out what it was. They used an FBI field examination kit, and they discovered it was the goal line. But they let the game resume because Carolina hadn't come close to it the whole game. It's a good thing that the motto of the state of South Carolina is Dumb Spiro Sparrow, while I breathe, I have hope. Excessive celebration rules. For instance, there are different rules for the NFL than for the NCAA, for college football and pro football. In pro football, you can only be given that 15-yard penalty for excessive celebration if you leave your feet or if you use a prop, meaning by prop either the goal post or the pylon for the goal line, or a towel perhaps. You can do the Lambeau leap, which Cam Newton does pretty often now, by jumping up into the end zone stands and giving a kid a football, because the stands and outside of the boundaries of the field, that's not counted as being a part of the playing field. So that's okay, Cam. That's good. Maybe. But then with the NFL, so you can't leave your feet and you can't use a prop, but you can do a group high five. You can choreograph all your gyrations or whatever else you want to do. I'm not going to try to exhibit any of that. I got the rhythm of the snail. They can do their fake rowboat stuff, and they can do like Steve Smith used to do for the Panthers, their snow angels in the end zone. Oh, that's legal. You can spike the football in the NFL, but you can't spike it toward anybody, or that's taunting, and you get ejected. But with the NCAA, it's different. You can't spike the ball at all. Immediately at the conclusion of the play, you have to immediately give the football back to the referee or place it on the dead ball spot where the play had ended, where it's blown dead. In the NCAA, this is what they say in their rules about excessive celebration. This is their definition. Any delayed, excessive, prolonged, or choreographed act by which a player draws attention to self. So in the NFL, you can do everything you want to just so you don't leave your feet or use a prop. But in NCAA, it's any delayed, excessive, prolonged, or choreographed act by which a player draws attention to self. It is a shame in my mind. This is where I really want to preach. It is a shame in my mind that any coach would have to use precious practice time to teach their players what's right and wrong in terms of being a team player. That you would use practice time to teach players who ought to know better about celebration when they ought to be playing the game and not how to show off. It's a shame that Jesus had to do that with the Pharisees. It's a shame that Jesus has to do that with me and you. Because we ought to know that being humble is better than being first. But most of us don't like any back seat unless it's at the back of the church. We would prefer to be first. But we need to be like Jesus. Jesus, who is described by the Apostle Paul in Philippians. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes about Jesus and about us. Says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be laid hold of, but he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Humility is to be like Jesus. Humility, being humble. This coming Thursday, September the 1st, is the 53rd anniversary of the Pro Football Hall of Fame's founding in Canton, Ohio. And you might wonder, why Canton, Ohio? Why is the NFL Pro Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio? Those of you from Canton, I know some of you are, and those of you from Ohio probably know it's because of the Canton Bulldogs. And you've probably never heard of the Canton Bulldogs. One of the first NFL football teams, the Canton Bulldogs. But it's primarily there, not just because of the Canton Bulldogs, but because of perhaps their most famous player and coach, whose name was Jim Thorpe. Now, I don't know what you know about Jim Thorpe, but Jim Thorpe was half Sac Indian, half Fox Indian from Oklahoma, raised poor. You know, in South Carolina, we're not that familiar with the fact that, yes, we had black schools, we had white schools, but also there were red schools. The last one that I know of in South Carolina is in Indian Town near Black Mingo Creek between Georgetown and Kingstree, South Carolina. But they were red schools, and Jim Thorpe went to a red school. Then he was sent off to Carlisle Industrial Indian School, where he was taught to dress like a white person, not use his native languages. He was mistreated. He was always humble, but he was always a natural athlete too. But he never wanted the spotlight. He never did any gyrations. He never, well, the only dancing that he did was with a girl, and he even won a contest doing that. He was so natural at movement. A great athlete. Played 6 years of Major League Baseball. Played for years and coached in the NFL, the Canton Bulldogs, and other teams. He was amazing. Played pro basketball. He went to the 1912 Stockholm Olympics. He won the decathlon and the pentathlon, two of the most grueling events in the Olympics. Some would say a lot more difficult than running a marathon because there are multiple sports that you have to excel in. He won both. And in that day, you got your medals at the end of the games. At the closing ceremony, you got your medal. And so King Gustav V of Sweden, putting the medals around Jim Thorpe's neck, said, "You are the greatest athlete in the world." And in his humble way, he couldn't even look the king in his eye. Have you ever noticed people who are humble have that deference about them and look down? He couldn't even look the king in his eye. And he looked down and he muttered, not in defiance, not to make some protest, not to call attention to himself. No, Jim Thorpe just simply looked down and said, "Thanks, King." That's it. Thanks, King. Well, you and I someday are going to meet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I pray that our King of Kings and Lord of Lords will say to each one of us, "Well done, good and faithful servants." And I hope that your humble response will be, "Thanks, King. I owe it all to you." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.